to the executive team, to the pastoral team. I give honor to and I thank you for this opportunity to come before you and minister the word. We are going to be talking about, as I said, part of the subject. We're going to be talking about overcoming darkness. Amen. If you want to stand for the reading of the word. Oh, you know what? Not if you want. Stand for the reading of the word. Amen. We'll give everybody just a couple of seconds and then we'll go ahead and jump into the reading of the word. We're looking at Genesis chapter 1. Looking at verse 2 through 4. And the earth was without form or void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved upon the waters, and God said, let there be light, and there was light. And God saw the light, and that it was good, and he divided light from the darkness. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you right now, Lord Jesus. Lord, thank you for your spirit that's already here, Lord Jesus. And Lord, I do have an extra prayer, Lord Jesus. Let the door of opportunity be open to the Ethiopian culture, Lord Jesus, that we can reach them right now, Lord Jesus. Lord, I ask right now that wherever you want to speak, whatever you want to say, use this vessel to speak your word, Lord Jesus. And let me, to the best of my ability, with a whole lot of your help to bring forth the word to this congregation, to this church. And Lord, let me decrease and you increase. We ask that this in your precious name, in Jesus' name. Amen. Overcoming darkness. I was at a conference about a few years ago and Brother Sam Emery, he kind of ministered on this just a little bit. He talked about how, in the first verse, he said God created the heavens and the earth, but all of a sudden there was an automatic change when we got to verse 2. And he said darkness covered the earth, but Sam Emery brought up something out of that. He said darkness is covered, but this, what God had created was already there. It's just the darkness covered it. So, let's think about this for a minute. God, Almighty Creator, He creates us, but at the same time, He creates a plan for us all the way through our life. But we have one problem. If you put Psalms 51:5 up there, we have one problem. Behold, I was shaped in iniquity and in sin that my mother could see me. God has step by step a plan for your life all the way through your life. But because we was conceived in sin, darkness covered that plan. And from time to time throughout your life, God will shine some light on that plan. If you ever sit back and just think about it, God has showed you something, and you're like, wow, that's going to be me. I'm going to do that. Or God starts making some changes in your life because he begins to shine light on that darkness and moves on that darkness back. And this is the first part of it. And then at some point, God begins to deal with you. He begins to deal with you. You begin to feel sorrow. If you begin to feel the need for him, then all of a sudden, God begins to bring you, show more light, and he begins to bring you into his kingdom. It's as we were shaped into iniquity, and which is wickedness and which is darkness. Like I said, could it be that Satan already knowing that God has a plan for you begins to make sure you try to not to keep go through with that plan. That he makes sure every distraction, everything you can get into, everything possible. And when we was out in the bar, and I thank God for the ones who like was in church and stuff, but for the rest of who was out there, all we saw was darkness. We didn't see anything of God at all. All we saw is ourselves and everything before that. But when God began to start ministering and start touching us, and then he started moving us towards his life, that really had a scripture. And that's what I gave you. It's like 1 Peter 2:9. It's like God brought us out from darkness to his marvelous light, and he stopped showing us the kingdom. Yeah. And then we became into the kingdom. And that's the first part. God, we begin to enjoy the joy of his kingdom. That's the first part of this. But I'm going to go to the second part. Second part of this. We begin walking with God for a while. Everything is good. We begin to learn God. We begin to learn about scripture. We begin changes begin to happen into our lives. Everything. Then all of a sudden, there's some stuff that God promised. God began to show his promises. He began to show his plans. He began to show his stuff that's going to be in your life. Then one scripture that he did say, with John 16:33, these things have I spoken unto you that ye might have peace. In the world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. The only thing about this is, God said, I have overcome the world. We still learning to overcome the world. And because we still learning to overcome the world, we start hitting tribulations. We start hitting trials, we start hitting ruts. And then all of a sudden, because we start hitting ruts, we start forgetting some things, stuff that God has revealed to us. We start forgetting about plans. We start forgetting about promises. Because we got stuff going on inside our lives, and then if we're going through all of that, and then all of a sudden, what's beginning to happen? Again, you wonder why you forget about promises. That darkness stop covering all the promises. You wonder why you forget about different revelations. You wonder why people backslide. We call it backsliding in the church. You know why people begin to backslide in the church? In the church, when they start going through tough times, they even though they've been in church for 10, 20 some years, and they should know the Bible up and down, scriptures, different things, all of a sudden, when they start going through something, and they begin to forget about the scripture that they know about, and darkness start covering that scripture that they learn. Standards. They start covering the scriptures. Hey, have you ever wondered how the church, if I remember doing history, the church had a dark time. Dark time. How did the church have a dark time? But out of that dark time, where they started off in truth, a lot of the truth has been covered over, and they begin to come up with their own stuff, and then all of a sudden, we wonder why we're going left field. Because Satan's still at work, and because what Satan deal with, when we go through tough times, and even say in the valley, we go to the valley of the shadow of death, shadows. The valley is supposed where you get built and strengthened. But sometimes, some of us go into that valley and we don't get built and strengthened. And then we go into the shadows and we go into the darkness and we come out weaker than what we are before. We come out less than what we are before. And we realize, we keep forgetting that Satan, when your mind is at the devil's playground, Satan still talks to us. He still begins to show you failures. He still begins, he come. We was in a Salvation Army, and one guy said this. He said, you already gotta have a plan. And he said, you gotta already have your plan step by step what your plan is. And I added to his comment was, Satan comes to you and he asks you what your plan is. Or he'll come to a child of God and say, oh, God has a plan for your life. Or he's like, yeah, he has a plan for my life. He got good stuff in my life. And then Satan asks, he said, what's the plan? And then we tell him our plan. If you ain't catch that, we tell him our plan. And we start, and we don't tell him the plan that God told us. We tell him what we start to come up with. We try to follow his plan, but we start coming, and then Satan goes from there. And then he begins to mess with you. He begins to change some things. And then all of a sudden, failure starts to happen. Why are you not moving forward? Why this is not going on? Why it seems like we try to do this? But God said that he promises to me. Why is this promise not happening? Why is this not happening? Why it seems like everything is just steady, still, and nothing happened? Darkness starts to cover over things. You don't want to say you become less of a person. You don't want to say you become less of a child of God. But then again, Satan began to let darkness start coming over there. And then he allowed people, even good people, to come around you. And they begin to tell you, they talk negative to you. Maybe you should do this, should have done this. Maybe you shouldn't have done this. Maybe you shouldn't have, maybe you should not. This wasn't for you. But God's promises are steadfast. If he said it, it's already said. It's just we have to fall into the plan. If I ask everybody, close your eyes for a minute. Just close your eyes. Person said that when you close your eyes, you see the back of your lids. Unfortunately, it's true, but then again, it's not true. If you keep your eyes closed long enough, and I ask any for you begin to see, you might see red lines, figures, or whatever. But if you keep your eyes long enough, images begin to start coming in your mind. Images, and if Satan is at work, images of failure, images of sin, Satan begin to remind you of stuff and everything. Even the Bible mentioned about the church going into a Laodicea state and where the church is asleep. And so Satan begin to mess with the church and say, this is how you're supposed to be. You're not supposed to be an overcomer. You're not supposed to be doing this. You're not supposed to be, everything's fine, everything's steady. You come to church, you're being a good Christian, and that's what we sell. And we forget all about the other stuff that God says. You reach another world, the plans that God has for you. We forget all about that. And long as darkness is there, we forget all about the things that he has mentioned. If he can put that much pressure on you, you stop doing what you're supposed to do. You limit yourself to what you're supposed to do. How do we overcome darkness? Last week, Orson kind of pulled out some scriptures that was in my message. How do we overcome darkness? The first scripture that I have is Proverbs 3:5-6. It said, trust in the Lord with all their heart and lean not to their own understanding. First part of that, lean not to our own understanding. Yes, we may be intelligent. Yes, we may think we can figure out God's word, but unfortunately, our thinking is not like his, so we can't lean to our understanding. So if he specifically lays out the plan, and even if it takes him long to lay out the plan, your impatience, your whatever, don't need to interfere. You need to stay calm. You need to stay steady. You need to be patient. You need to let him do what he's about to do. If you don't, expect failures, expect going into darkness, expect stuff not being done. Because we lead into our own understanding. He has a plan set for each one of us, but you don't need to rush that plan. You You don't need to help God out. Too many people in the Bible try to help God out, yeah, and they produce a mess. One example was Abraham and Sarah. God said, you're going to have a child, and they were above age. So in other words, it has to be God's plan if they were out of their range. And then for some of us, this is out of our range. It has to be God's plan if it's out of your range. But we want to help things out. We want to push things. And we produce a mess when we do that. Not being patient. It said, acknowledge him. Okay? The scripture Proverbs. And all that way, acknowledge him. If you have a problem with something with God, you need to talk with him. There's less talk with him. Instead of us saying, we'll go and complain to other people, but we want to go talk to God about it. Where is that? It's an acknowledge him in all the ways. Talk to him. God is going to talk, and he will direct your path. He's got to be the director, not you. The next scripture, Psalm 119, overcoming darkness. Thy words are a lamp unto thy feet and a light unto my path. The word. Brother Orson talked about this last week. You must know your word. Especially if God used that word in whatever plan that he set for you. Because the enemy will come and ask you. If you add any part to that, there will be a problem. Because the enemy has you. If God said it's going to be all right, then it's going to be all right. Then why are you still worrying? Why are you still trying to force the issue if he already said if it's going to be all right? And he's holding that lamp, the word. If darkness is there, and you've been led by the word, what ends up happening is God begins to shine the light. All of a sudden, you're like, God shines the light over here. Then you all of a sudden you see, okay, you need to pray more. Add more 30 more minutes to your prayer. Because God shine a little bit further out this way, you begin to see that trial coming, or you begin to see whatever he's about to bring to you, and you need to be prepared for it. God shines the light. Okay, you need 21 days of prayer, fasting. He shines the light because he's trying to prepare you. Okay, so he's clearing away, and he's ordering your steps. He's walking your steps because he's trying to prepare you for what you need to be ready for. The next scripture, be still and know I am God. And I'm trying not to be blunt with this, but some of us, we talk too much. We talk too much. We don't just talk too much on the regular, we talk too much in prayer. We talk too much in prayer. I know, and we used to do corporate prayer, we say, okay, we have an hour of corporate prayer. So we try to boast ourselves and try to put, right now I need to pray about, I need to pray about this. And we did, we prayed, 15 minutes go by, you finish with everything you prayed for, so you start going to repetition, oh Lord, and all of this stuff. And there's no time for God to talk. And then besides prayer, God wants to show up anytime to talk with you. But if you're so busy, and you're so distracted, he can't talk to you. There's time that God just showed up, because at that particular time, my mind was still. I wasn't thinking about nothing, and then he all of a sudden just began to talk. And okay. And he don't talk about your failures, or he don't talk about it. He talks about continuing on with what the plan is. And you're like, I thought that was dead.
Yeah.
I thought we failed that, but that was dead. But he's like, he just talking that, he don't even acknowledge that, he just began to talk. God wants to talk to us.
Yeah.
And he wants to speak.
Yeah.
he really wants to speak. Next scripture. For thou wilt light my candle, and the Lord will enlighten my darkness. This is more of the spirit. When you go through darkness, sometimes the darkness takes a toll on you, and your counter begins to get very, very low. So when it starts getting low, it's time to let God begin to lighten it and light the fire more. So you begin to shine. So you should not be even looking at that much darkness, but you need to see some stuff other than yourself, other than your failures, other than the stuff you're going through. So he said, he likes to kind of enlighten our darkness. The next scripture is, and actually I basically talked about that. For we were sometimes darkness, but now ye are light in the Lord. Walk as children of the light. If you got the Holy Ghost in you, there's no time. It should be no time that you should be walking in darkness. Unfortunately, but we still walking anyway. But we gotta remember, if you got the Holy Ghost inside of you, you have the light of the world. You have the light inside of you. So it said, hide it under a bushel. No, I'm gonna let it shine. We need to be shining all the time. We need to let the Spirit move and shine through us. Amen. I want to go back to Genesis. Genesis 1. Verse 3. To go back to verse 2 right quick. The last part of that, it said, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. As the scripture said, stir up the Spirit. There should be no dead church at any time. At any time. Our altars should not be empty at any time. Yeah, and I know eventually at some point we'll get to, especially when we get on and build the prayer lights, should not be empty at any time. There's a lot of revelations, and it needed power about testimony of revelation with people, even at prayer. And they stirred up the Spirit, and God began to show them things going to happen in like 4 or 5 years in the future for them. Stirring up the Spirit with show you shine lightning victory. Stirring of the Spirit will show lightning deliverance. Stirring of the Spirit will show lightning healing. Stirring of the Spirit will show victory for you overcoming.
Yep.
Stirring of the Spirit. And I'm not just saying to stand up here, and it's more than just speaking in tongues. It's actually letting God move whatever situation you're going. It said it's dark that was over the deep. The first part said it was void. And darkness upon the face of the deep. Is that when the Spirit gets moved, the Spirit is not going to deal with the surface stuff. The Spirit is going to deal with the deep stuff that you will not reveal.
Yeah.
But if you sit there and you're going to fight with it, God is not going to fight against you. The Spirit won't deal with the deep stuff. Did Spirit want to deal with those stuff, with that stuff that you had in closets, that you had in the way back in the deep part of your hearts? It's a time to stir up the Spirit, and it's time for God to move. And then that's part of verse 3. And God said, let there be light, and there was light. In verse 4, it said, and God saw the light, and that it was good. And God began to divide the light from the darkness. It's time to be a dividing light from the darkness. God wants to illuminate some stuff for them in hope. You know what? God wants to do, now I'm just a good person. He wants to do some stuff for me. He wants to do some stuff for my family. He already has plans set up for us. I told Bishop some time ago, I begin to let darkness affect me. And I begin to let what people say affect me. And I actually step back. I step back in responsibilities and all of that. But through all of that, God, I guess when he began to talk, he was doing a little bit of rebuke towards me. And he began to remind me of promises that I had pushed back into the corner.
Speak on worship. Because that's Sister Gibson.